doesn't matter if it's legal. Slavery is evil, and you're a part of it. Boom. All the way up. Damn it! Failure. He mulls over what you said, scowling as he does. Doesn't matter, he says finally. A job's a job, and we gotta eat. There's nothing you could say will change our minds, he rubs his chin pensively. But maybe we can make a deal. This girl has been a pain of in our collective backside, and taking her back across the city is bound to be a sharper pain still. He snaps his fingers. Tell you what, give me 140 shins and we never saw you. Deal? No way, man. Gonna have hardly anything left. He thinks, I'd feel better about that anyway. How could I tell my family I took a girl to a slaver so we could eat? Quick, reach out and snap his neck. I'm gonna use his thoughts against him. I'm not giving the money. That's gonna break us, man. We only have 234. You look like a family man. Are you really gonna tell your family they're living on slaver money? His eyes pop open in shock. Did you... how... He shakes his head. Damn it, you're right. Take the girl, then. And don't make me regret it, hear? He thinks, how are we gonna eat tonight, though? Come on, lads. I'd give him a little money, but not 140.
Oh, God, thank you. They were going to take me back to that woman. I've never met anyone so cruel. When she found me the first time she even... My apologies. I'm still out of sorts. You have my thanks and grace, sir.
My lady, she says, sir. I guess they didn't, you know... They could have recorded this line over with sir at the end. I mean, my lady at the end. Well, that's cool, though. Some dialogue. I mean, some voice acting. For a moment, it looks like she might hug you, but at the last moment, she... seems to think better of it and pulls up short a half dozen steps away. She collects herself, standing straight with her shoulders back. Then she nods, the gesture so polite it's almost formal. Oh, she's so cute.
My name is Rin. My home and hearth and bread are yours to use. Except I don't have any of those things.
Aww. She blushes then, looking around self-consciously. How long were you hiding in that building? She blinks a little, as if confused or surprised at your question. Then she looks around, shifting nervously from foot to foot. This is my place. This is where I... sleep. This is your home? She looks at the shattered wreckage. No, this is just where I was staying. I ran away. My home is a long way from here. Where are you from? She looks out the horizon and makes a vague gesture, really far away, but I am not sure exactly which direction. She looks around a little, almost as if she was seeking a familiar landmark. It has to be a long way from here. My home isn't anything like this. There were trees upon trees. The trees here aren't trees like... The young girl squints off into the distance. After a moment, her eyes go distant, and you realize she probably isn't going to finish her sentence. He was saying something about trees? She looks at you oddly. What? No, I wasn't. Huh. Another person with like two personalities or something. Without seeming to realize what she's doing, the girl brushes her hand through her hair, and you see that the side of her head has been shaved. Large stitches run along her scalp, holding together an ugly cut longer than her hand. The wound is purple and angry-looking, only just beginning to heal. It can't be more than a week old. Well, where are you from again? Father always said you're never lost so long as you can see the moon. What happened to your head? Her body grows tense for a moment, her eyes darting around as if deciding whether or not to run away. She glances at the rubble where she had hidden from the thugs. She relaxes, though her eyes are still wary. I was running away. There were some people. Bad people. I ran away and got hurt. Your scar looks pretty bad. Are you okay? She makes a dismissive gesture toward her temple. It's fine. It looks a lot worse than it is. And a lot better than yours, anyway. She smirks, touching the side of her head. The haircut is pretty awful, though, isn't it? I don't think they really needed to shave quite this much, do you? I don't know. I think it looks dashing. Fashionable, even. You might start a trend. Gold and silver went up tiny. She gives a wide grin. I'll be the envy of every homeless waif in this entire... She gestures grandly at the landscape, then hesitates. Barrow? Her grin fades as the word comes out of her mouth. Sorry, I meant barrow. She pauses, then said, I know that's not the right word. I mean barrow. She keeps saying it. Her grin is entirely gone now, and her hands make fists as she looks down at the ground, concentrating. Her lips move, and at first you can't hear anything except for the hint of a whisper. Finally, her body relaxes. Yes, neighborhood. That's the word I was looking for. Neighborhood. She looks up and gives you a shaky smile. I offer apologies. It's been a long day. She's so polite and well-spoken for a little kid. What people were you running away from? She opens her mouth, then closes it again. She nods and puts her hands back into her pocket absent-mindedly. I don't really remember. I think there were... Stealers. No. What's the word? Robbers. They wanted to rob me. I don't really remember. I think they wanted to rob me. Who stitched your head back together after you got hurt? For just a moment, her eyes flash with panic again, and they dart around like she's getting ready to run. Then she touches the side of her head gingerly. I don't remember what happened exactly, but I got away, and I ran, and I ended up here. She really doesn't like when we ask her about her head. Is there anything I can do to help? She shrugs nonchalantly. I don't know. I'm pretty good here. Unless you happen to have any spare food you aren't using, or water, or a blanket, or a new bed, or a house, or, you know, anything at all. Rin starts out talking with a playful smile on her face, but then her eyes well up. Her voice stays cheerful even as the tears are running down her cheeks. Aww. She wipes them away, embarrassed and angry, but her hands are shaking now, and there are more tears, and words continue to pour out of her. I offer apologies. It's just that I've been hungry for days. I don't know where I am. My head hurts and nothing makes sense. She laughs then, helplessly, with a tinge of trembling panic finally bleeding into her tone. God's around me. I'm all broken in my head. The moon is wrong, and I'm so tired of being scared all the time. I'll take care of you. Come with me. Gold Tide raised a small amount. She blinks up at you and gives a huge grin. Really? Then she looks at your companions and seems to shrink away. No, I'm all right. I mean, thank you, but I'm all right. I don't want her to run. What's a little girl doing all alone here? The girl looks up at you, her forehead creasing a little in irritation. My name is Rin. But then she hesitates and looks down, blinking. She reaches into her pocket absent-mindedly. Did I forget to tell you that? She stands there motionless for a second, then stops and looks up at you again. No, I think I did. She looks up at you. I'm sorry, she says. My name is Rin. My food and fire are yours to use before you go. What happened to your head again? I was running away from some bad people. I got hurt. Your story doesn't fit. Who fixed your wound and shaved your head? If you could hardly sit up, how did you keep running? Lou. She scowls at you fiercely. I didn't know I was talking to a judge, she says angrily. I told you I can't remember. Not for days on either side of whatever happened. She looks away, mouth pressed into a firm line. Oh God, I'm not gonna say that. I'm sorry, Rin. I was just trying to help. It seems like you've had a rough couple days. Gold Tiny. She gives a wavering smile. Oh, it's not all bad. I found some shimmery berries today. So that means I get to play I Wonder If This Will Poison Me Later. That's always exciting. Oh my God. Why don't you come with us? She looks at each of your companions in turn. I think I would feel safer here. Alright. Farewell, Rin.
I'll remember that.
Oh, it's you. What brings you back here? She looks at all three of your companions in the back of you. Quite sure, yes. Well, they're nice people. And this guy isn't even with us. He's way over on the other side of the map. Alright, so... quests. We are blue. Gold is rising! We're blue and gold. We were blue and then blue silver, then blue, then blue silver, now we're blue gold. The gold tide represents empathy, compassion, and sacrifice. People attuned to this tide consider the needs of those they care about to be greater than any other consideration. Martyrs, philanthropists, avengers, and guardians are often attuned to this tide. Cool. That's not... convince Rin to join the party. I found Rin hiding in the ruins of a collapsed building in Cliff's Edge, but I still need to convince her to join my party so I can bring her back to Toll. How do I do that? Yeah, Aiden Salavos or... Yeah, I don't know. I guess we'll be back when we find out how to do that. I looked at that. What's over here? Oh, we can, like... we can get these things working again, maybe? There's no way... not even an option to do it. Oh, his loss of self! Cool. This young woman clutches herself and growls, low and continuously under her breath. Pearly white light shimmers from a vial on her wrist, and her eyes are red-rimmed as if she's been crying. You've never seen her before, and yet your hands are sweating and your breath catches in your inherited chest. Inherited chest. Shame burns your throat, hot and sour. Your body recognizes her, even if you do not. And she thinks, this isn't you, only I am real. You don't need to fight me. Leave me alone, she mutters, and it's a moment before you realize she's not talking to you. You took my face, stole my family, whisper at me in my own voice. Isn't that enough? Isn't that... she breaks off when she sees you. She's in my head and she won't shut up. Talk loud. Talk over her so I can hear you. You hear a woman in your head? Yes, she says, biting the word like an enemy's throat. Now stop talking about her. It brings her forward and she clings. She whines and she won't stop, so please stop talking about her. She thinks, I am not the same, I am not some woman. I am you. Please let me in. What is that shining object you're holding? She flinches but reveals the vial strapped to her wrist. It glows with an inner light, and the tiny ripples within seem to cast moving shadows under her palm. I woke up one night in a building I'd never seen before, she says, soft and low. I found this beneath a pile of blackened scales. If you shake it, it makes a picture. Watch. She jiggles the vial and holds up her other hand. Indistinct shadows mimic the motion on her palm. Why are you holding on to it? Because I feel like it was mine, she blurts, then grimaces, as if the words escaped without her permission. At any rate, it's mine now, and I don't need more of a reason than that. She thinks, it's mine. I don't need more of a reason than that. Why is it so important to you again? It's not that it's important, she says, frowning. I just feel better holding it, and there's nothing wrong with that. I want to ask about something else. Good, she says with visible relief. Mother Tamaz sent me. I want to help. That grim old sack of bones, she says, trying to smile. I've never been able to fool her. No one can. She grips her head, staring at you from between the bars of her forearms. I've been hearing a woman's voice for a long time. She tells me that everything I know about who I am is wrong, and her words are persuasive. With a sound that's half chuckle, half sob, she continues, I can't remember my childhood or my family. Last year I forgot my name, but that's not all. I see people who look like me around the city. They have my face. They speak in my voice. and once I saw a ghost of her in the fifth eye. It was the woman in my head. She had a kind face, but it was sad, like she knew she was going to win, to take over my body, but didn't want to. She clenches her fist. She won't win. I'll kill myself first. How long have you been hearing this voice? 6, 7 years? Okay, we're talking about it again. At first, it was just a whisper behind my thoughts. Then I started forgetting simple things, like where a scarf was. Then one day I woke up and I couldn't remember my mother's face. Her eyelids flutter. I wish I wasn't scared, but I'm terrified. You're not alone. I'll help you, whatever it takes. Gold, tiny. Thank you, she says. Her smile is a fragile, beautiful thing. Tell me about the ghost you saw in the fifth eye. That's the bar we passed, or club, whatever. She looked like... No, she was me. But I could see through her to the pipes on the walls. At first she wouldn't look over. Then she did, and the voice in my head. I couldn't hear words, but it felt like glass breaking, ripping my mind to slivers and shreds. She swallows hard. She was crying. She knew she was hurting me and couldn't stop. She's kind, understand? I hate her for
that.
I
remember that.
Her voice goes quiet. She's still there, in the fifth eye. She's always there. Have you ever tried talking to her? Reasoning with her? Why? She exclaims, tears of pain glittering at the corners of her eyes. Why should I talk to her when I can hear her right now? It's her, the woman in my head. I know it is. I want to talk about your family. I told you, I can't even bring their faces to mind. Just shapes. Shapes in a sea of that damned woman's words. She clenches her eyes shut. I know you're trying to help, but you don't understand. Her whispers eat at me. They peel me away. How am I supposed to stop her when I don't even know who I am? She thinks, they're not real. They never were. Only I am real. So this is the, whatever, ghost thoughts, I think. Whining won't help, my God. Funny you should ask. I'm missing a lot of memories, too. Gold. Her lip quirks, and for a moment she looks more likely to laugh than cry. What a pair we are, she says. It's nice to know I'm not the only one. There's nothing you can say that I haven't already tried, she adds. Her mouth trembles. She won't stop talking. She'll never leave. Someone must know who you are. Yes, but either they haven't come looking or they haven't found me. She mashes her forehead with the heel of her hand. I'm not an idiot. I've thought about asking in Government Square. The council is supposed to have information on everyone. She laughs bitterly. But I've never made it there. Every time I try, I get lost, or I forget where I'm going. It's hopeless. And someone thinks no one knows you because you aren't real. Only I am. Let me in. You said there might be records about your past. Where would they be again? Government Square, she says, her brow wrinkling. She appears to have forgotten that she was the one who brought up the idea. The council has records on everyone. I have other questions. Good. Maybe this time you can think of something I haven't tried. Oh my God. Throw yourself off the cliff and find... Oh my God. I could never do that. Can I look at that shining vial of yours again? All right, she says dully, grimacing. I'm not gonna deceive her. Mother Tomas thinks you should be able to handle this on your own, and I do too. I'll take that from her, she says, balling her hands into fists. She's a petrified branch of a woman with more willpower than sense, but I know she cares for me. You don't get to echo her when you don't know how hard I've fought this, she swallows. How much I've failed. Good God. I'll return when I find a way to help you. groans. Now, if we can repair this bridge, I don't even see a way to do it. Maybe we can go through the Fifth Eye Tavern, through the back or something? I don't even know.
Coming.
Coming, dear. What's up here? Oh, we didn't talk to this Finzin guy. Psst. Everything about this slender young man says thug. From his scar-slashed eyebrows to the calloused hand hovering over his hip where a dagger would hang, but he doesn't have one. Instead, flour cakes his hands, and a single apron string hangs from his pocket. He is apparently a baker. Okay, not a thug? Stand still, you shine, he says, and peers over your shoulder. You follow his gaze to an armored soldier who is loitering in the public square. That Levy's been following me for days. Can't even stop for a piss without checking side to side. I know what it is, what a Levy is by now, of course. I'm just going to ask him. See what he says. What's a Levy? What's a... He sputters. You new in town? There's one right over there. No, don't look. He shoots another nervous look over his shoulder. They're the law, right? You must have seen them. Always smiling, even if they're snapping the chains on. Nope. But not this one. No, he just follows around from dawn to dark, staring at me, trying to trap me in alleys. I ain't done nothing wrong. And it's worse than that, he says, wringing his hands. That's my Levy. What do you mean he's your Levy? I'm a citizen, he says, as if this explains it. When it becomes clear it hasn't, he groans. Every Levy is made from a citizen, he says. This one was made from me. Look, I can't explain why, but I know that one's mine. I feel it, right? And now it's coming for me. Look, he won't leave me alone, right? I gave a year of my life to make him, and I thought that was that. Now I catch him standing in the street outside the bakery, whispering to himself, playing with that carving of his. His teeth graze his lip as he leans closer. He even tried to talk to me. Levy's ain't supposed to know who they came from, right? They ain't supposed to know who you are. He wavers, gathering his courage. Could you talk to him? Find out what he wants? Can't you talk to him yourself? He swallows hard. I've heard stories. Levy's go wrong sometimes. Get obsessed with this person who gave them life. If the two ever meet, the Levy goes mad, tears him apart. That ain't gonna happen to me. Not after... He cuts himself off. Not after all I've been through. All right, I'll talk to you, Levy. He nods again towards the armor man who's standing a distance away in the public square. He's the only Levy in this district, so you can't miss him. Plus, he ain't smiling like all the others, and he's holding some charred wooden thing in his hands. Yeah, we've met.
I'll remember that.
You, need anything else? Well, we got a flawed simulacrum? Huh? I don't understand why you think your Levy wants to murder you. Look, he begins, obviously struggling to frame his explanation. Look, he tries again. Look, you don't track a man for days and days unless you want something, yeah? Maybe you like his shoes, or you're curious about how many shins he's got. Now, I don't have any shins, and my shoes are older than me. Only thing I got worth anything is my life. Anyway, I told you about the stories I've heard, how sometimes Levy's go wrong. He shudders. You take a look at that Levy. Everything about him is wrong. What is normal behavior for a Levy, anyway? There... He hesitates, raising his hands as if he's trying to contain his response before he lets it escape his mouth. They work for the people who make the laws, right? And if someone breaks those laws, they track them down. Always smiling, mind you. Figures that my Levy would be the unhappy kind. Tracking down those who break the law, and as you can see, he ain't smiling and I ain't done anything wrong. How did they create your Levy? I look like a skylark to you? All I know is where they told me to stand. His eyes rove past your face and snap back. Look, people who want to be, you know, respectable in this town, they become citizens. The way you do that is if you step into this glass chamber. Takes a year out of your life, they say. I figured it squeezes that year into human shape. Don't know how. Wouldn't pay two shins to know. They take a year from you and make a Levy out of it. Don't know how they do it or why. Don't want to know. I'll be here.
No
Don't mind if I do. Okay, unhappy Levy. Good to see you again, miss, the Levy says, still staring across the plaza. Tears roll silently down his cheeks. Finzin sent me to find out why you're following him. Yes? He says, the despair melting away. In that moment he looks like a child with a child's desperate hope. He knows too, doesn't he? He sees what he did. What we did. Tears leak from his eyes, trailing down into his mouth as he continues. When the machine ripped the year from him to make me, I felt the choices unraveling before me. He hugs himself. I see them coming. None of it can be changed.
Making a note.
Tell him this, for me. The Gillam Manor job did happen. A servant caught him, called the Levies. They chased him, and he set a fire. His eyes squeezed shut. The fire spread through the neighborhood. People were trapped. People screamed. His hand clenches over the charred toy bird in his palms with a soft crunch. Oh, it's from the fire. Please tell him. Tell him I'm with him in the dark, hiding from the mobs, sobbing. Tell him to give me a different year, a better one. You mean you could choose what years you want to give? And they're actually, like, years from your past? I figured it would be a year from your future. What kind of year do you want from Finzin? A year without the blackened door, he says earnestly, without the hand tangled in the grate, the weeping in the dark places. Silent tears stream down his face. He doesn't seem to be aware of them. Wails rising with the glowing ashes, my arms bound with ragged rope. Every time I'm there, in those last minutes, I try to apologize, but my mouth... His fingertips brush at his lips. My mouth is full of dirt and blood. He gave me the only one he had left, though he didn't know it. Now he has more because of me. I just want one of them. So he doesn't remember the Gillam Manor job because all the memories and experiences are in him. Apparently. Hold on, I'll speak with Finzin. Groans. We are the go-betweeners. Did you find out anything? He asked, eyes darting around you to check on the distant Levy. I've spoken to the Levy. He mentioned something about a Gillam Manor job. He what? Finzin says, going pale. Keep your voice down. You tell anyone else about this? No. Good. He lowers his voice. I have to be, unspecific about this, understand? Before I became a citizen, I wasn't a nice person. I took things, for money, and just a few weeks ago certain people told me they wanted me to rob Gillam Manor. He grimaces, rubbing his neck. I was going to do it, but then I became a citizen. Gave up a year of my life to create the Levy. That Levy. So it's something he was going to do in the future? Something changed, he says, frowning. All of a sudden I couldn't get the dangers out of my head. How thick the Levy patrols were. Like... or how the captain herself was looking into one of my older adventures. He plays with the apron strings hanging from his pocket. So I canceled the job and started working at my aunt's bakery. Never did a Gillam job, and that's the truth. Oh, really? So it is a year from his future. The Levy is seeing what would have happened if you did the job. He wants another year from you.
Making a note.
Oh, I get it. He says, rolling his eyes. It's a shakedown. Give me a year, or I'll tell them what you did. Well, I ain't done anything. I never killed anyone, and I don't owe him nothing. I can't keep handing out years like they're free. That's not fair. He's suffering for what you would have done. Golden Indigo. I ain't ever been in the same town as fair, he says, shaking his head. You ever find it, you let me know.
Updated my journal.
I love that. I'd go up to Government Square and tell the captain of Levy's what he's up to. If I had any way of explaining it. Hey, your Levy is following me around. I think it's because he's haunted by my criminal past. What good would telling the captain of Levy's do? Levy's ain't supposed to follow their citizens around. They ain't supposed to get all weepy either. Telling the captain would take care of the problem for sure, but I ain't about to try it myself. He shrugs. You want to try talking to her? She's in Government Square. I was going to try to persuade him, but that's not there now. I'll see what I can do. Wait here. Good luck. Just don't, you know, tell her too much. Okay. Government Square. Circus Miner is back that way. Underbelly. You know, let's look around more. Let's go in here.
Yes.
I want to find the easy way back to Government Square first. We'll just finish looking around. I have two things to do there. The shape of this operating table provides little information regarding the physiology of the beings it was originally designed to treat. These shelves abound with beakers, flasks, and other myriad containers. The utter lack of labels on any of them is somewhat worrying. The books jamming the shelves of this desk are divided equally between obscure medical texts and mechanical how-to manuals. These displays show information regarding patients, conveniently visible from anywhere within the parlor. Got a Pequo over there. Alright, so these things. Surgical drones. I got this guy here.